Hello students, having understood the Competition Act, its provisions at length, I am going to discuss various case laws which give out a kind of information to you to understand how the implementation and execution of the Act is seen. For this purpose, most often we look at live examples in form of the judgments or the cases that come before the Commission or the cases that are adjudicated by the Commission. For the purpose of our understanding, I have divided the case law discussion or the judgments passed by the Commission or orders given by the Commission into two kind of sessions. Session 1, I would be dealing with various powers, inquiry, and also with regard to the procedure for inquiry that is to be undertaken by the Commission or the Director General who are vested with the powers to implement the provisions of the Act. Further, in the second session with regard to the case law discussion, I will be focusing primarily on the penalties imposed by the Commission with reference to any contravention that it identifies. For understanding the case laws that I would be discussing, all of you must recollect the most important provisions of the Competition Commission Act, which focus on the entire anti-competitive regime. For this purpose, you need to bear in mind Section 3, which talks about prohibited agreements which are anti-competitive, Section 4, which talks about abuse of dominant position, and Section 5, which talks about what are combinations, and Section 6, which talks about regulation of combination. You must understand these provisions, which we had discussed at length under Chapter 2 session, which we had dealt with various aspects that are seen as anti-competitive issues. Going forward, while I discuss the cases, I would request all the students to make a reference to each of these sections that are under discussion in form of a case study in certain important cases which are drawn from the orders passed by the Competition Commission of India. The first case that I would like to discuss is with relation to abuse of dominant position. The case is titled as Owners Association versus DLF Limited, Huda and others. This case deals with an issue relating to abuse of dominant position. The facts of this case are that an application was moved under Section 19(1A). Section 19(1A) talks about the power of initiating inquiry by the Competition Commission of India. Now, after the application under 19(1A) was filed, a grievance was raised to the said application alleging that the DLF is abusing its dominant position and is imposing certain highly arbitrary and unfair and unreasonable conditions on apartment allottees of certain housing complexes undertaken by it under the guise of saying that there is an extra space that's being provided to the allottees, and under that concept it endeavored to impose certain heavy charges. These charges were opposed by the applicants and they called this abuse of dominant position. Now, the issue that stood before the Commission to address was, did DLF Limited — you all must be familiar with DLF. DLF is a huge construction company which indulges in construction of housing apartments and commercial spaces all over the country and the world. And the issue that stood before the Commission was that, did DLF abuse its dominant position in the relevant market by imposing certain conditions which would affect the consumers at large? On examining the case and although understanding the terms imposed on the consumers, the Commission held that DLF enjoys a dominant position in the relevant market, and this is a prima facie case, and it tantamounts an imposition of conditions relating to certain aspects which the consumers would have not anticipated, would tantamount to abuse of dominant position and comes within the ambit of Section 4 of the Act. So, if you observe, Section 4 of the Act, which deals with abuse of dominant position, came to the rescue of the consumers to show that DLF, which is in a dominant position, can use its position to impose certain conditions which would cause a kind of loss to the consumers, would be treated as anti-competitive under Section 4 of the Act. The next case that I am going to discuss is a case relating to prohibited agreements. This case is a very important case which we often come across this issue as consumers. The case name is Consumers Guidance Society versus Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages. The facts of this case are as follows. Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages entered into an agreement, Inox Theatres. All of you must be familiar with Inox Theatres. Through this agreement, there was an understanding reached between both Inox and Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages that they would supply water bottles and other beverages at a fixed price, which is workable for both these companies. Now, the consumers of the services in Inox Theatre were compelled to purchase the only available beverage sold by Coca-Cola or Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages to Inox. What was the issue that was raised by the consumers? The consumers raised an issue that Coca-Cola and Inox together formed an agreement through which they have created an anti-competitive regime by imposing exorbitant and expensive price of any beverages sold through these Inox theaters. This matter was taken up by the commission, and the commission framed an issue whether both these companies, that is Hindustan Coca-Cola Beverages and Inox, entered an agreement that contravenes the provisions of section 3 subsection 4 read with section 19(3) of the Competition Act. On examining the case and also the facts provided to the commission held that exclusive supply agreement entered into between both these companies, that is Inox and Coca-Cola, have contravened the provisions of section 3 subsection 4 of the Act and held this agreement to be anti-competitive. This decision of the commission is a commendable decision because such kind of monopolistic or exclusive agreements are formed in many of the services which are never challenged by the consumers. As we discussed through this case, what you must understand is section 19(1)(a) provides an opportunity not just for a company or a trader to raise an issue before the commission, but an individual applicant or a consumer can raise an issue with regard to any anti-competitive regime or agreements of the nature which we just discussed in the current case. So, bear in mind that any agreements which are exclusive, which lay down certain exorbitant prices to the consumers under guise of a trading transaction, can be challenged under section 3 of the Competition Act 2002. The next case that I am going to discuss is a 2014 judgment which talks about combinations. The case name is Jitendra Bhargava versus Competition Commission of India and others. The facts of this case are that in this case the Competition Commission, or an application made by two airways, what is Etihad Airways and Jet Airways, for a merger or a combination which they were forming, and sought its permission under section 6 subsection 2 of the Competition Act. You must be familiar with this. There is a mandatory requirement under section 6 subsection 2 to obtain the permission of the commission prior to commencing a combination. The permission was accorded by the commission, and this permission approval was challenged by Mr. Jitendra Bhargava, and the only issue that was left before the commission was whether the combination permitted by the Competition Commission of India between Etihad Airways and Jet Airways contravenes the provisions under section 5 of the Competition Act. In this case, it was held that Mr. Jitendra Bhargava has no locus standi for the fact that the due process required for the grant of permission for the combination to take place was given and considered by the Competition Commission of India. Therefore, Mr. Jitendra has no locus standi to raise an appeal against the order of the Competition Commission of India before the Competition Appellate Tribunal. Now, this, if you were to look at this judgment, what has to be borne in mind is the principle with regard to challenging any combination, or you have to also examine a combination which is being challenged after permission is granted. the appellant perhaps would have to focus more on the manner in which the permission was accorded. When I'm saying the manner, the procedure in which the procedure, whether there's a non-compliance of procedure in terms of granting a combination, could be a ground for challenge rather than simply challenging it by raising vague grounds. As you must note, students, you must focus on understanding whether a combination has been approved without due process or procedure as contemplated on the Act, have to be examined for the purpose of raising an issue on such combinations. The other case that I am going to discuss is Hyundai Motor India Limited versus Competition Commission of India. This is a very interesting case because in this case, Hyundai Motors India Limited, which was not a party to the issue raised before the Competition Commission of India, moved the High Court of Madras and challenged the orders passed by the Competition Commission of India, saying that such an order cannot bind Hyundai Motors India Limited, which is not a party to the proceedings. Keeping this background in mind, let's get into understanding the facts. The case that came up before the Competition Commission of India was that an applicant raised an issue stating that three automobile companies, that is Honda Sial Cars India Limited, Volkswagen India Private Limited, Fiat India Automobiles Limited, are indulging in acts of anti-competitive, contravening provisions of Section 3 and Section 4. The Competition Commission of India, which took up the case, preliminary directed the Director General to carry out an investigation and file its report within 60 days, which is statutory requirement under the Competition Act. Now, in course of conducting the investigation, the order of the Competition Commission of India also recorded that the Director General can also proceed against such or similar automobile companies which are indulging in the acts alleged by the applicant. The Director General took up the matter for investigation and proceeded further against not just the three companies against whom the allegation was raised, but also other companies that are indulging in such an act. Aggrieved by this action, Hyundai Motor India Limited challenged the Competition Commission order by filing a writ petition before the High Court, and the High Court took up this matter and framed an issue with regard to find whether the order passed by the Competition Commission of India directing the Director General to carry out investigation on persons other than against whom the allegation is raised who are in similar line of business was not in accordance with the provisions of the Act. The High Court, and the main issue that was raised before High Court, was the Director General has no power to initiate any investigation suo motu. Now, this issue was discussed at length by the High Court, and the High Court clarified that the provisions of the Competition Act only empowers the Director General to assist the Commission in investigation and not to form any opinion which would be binding for the purpose of the Competition Commission of India to adopt. This judgment clarifies that the orders of the Commission passed for the purpose of investigation would relate specifically to the specific issue raised by the Competition Commission of India and cannot arbitrarily stretched by the Director General to other companies which are not facing such allegations. In essence, the Director General is only obligated to carry out investigation and not form opinions for the Commission, and which have to be adopted by the Commission. So, the principle of law laid down here is that it clarified, this judgment clarified the powers and the scope of functioning of the Director General within the scope of the Competition Act 2002. Now, let's move on to the next case. This case relating to another technical issue on powers relating to the Competition Commission of India. The case that I am going to discuss is Google Inc. and others versus Competition Commission of India and other. The facts of this case are that a complaint was filed against Google before the Competition Commission alleging that it is indulging in abuse of dominant position by advertising its other search engines such as YouTube, Google News, and Google Maps, in addition to the Google services it provides. The matter was taken up by the Competition Commission of India, and an investigation was ordered through the Director General, and a prima facie opinion, a prima facie report was given by the Director General, and an order was passed directing Google to restrain from indulging in such acts. Challenging this order, Google filed recall petitions on the ground stating that it has not been given an opportunity of being heard. You must note, opportunity of being heard was not given to Google because that was an order passed ex parte. Therefore, taking this opposition raised by Google, the Competition Commission ruled that the Competition Commission has no jurisdiction to recall or review its own orders. Aggrieved by the order of the Commission, Google moved the High Court, challenging the orders passed by the Commission, and sought a clarification whether the Competition Commission of India has inherent powers to review or recall its orders passed under Section 26, Subsection 1, in absence of any specific provisions in the Competition Act 2002. This matter was discussed at length, and the court observed that the Competition Commission has the power to recall and review its orders relating to jurisdiction raised by it before the Commission by any of the person aggrieved by its orders. So, this judgment clarifies that Competition Commission of India has the power to review and recall its orders when particularly they are passed where an opportunity of hearing is not given to the party who is aggrieved. The next case that we are going to discuss is Yashoda Hospitals and Research versus India Bulls Financial Services. In this case, a complaint has been filed against India Bulls Financial Services alleging that they are charging certain floor closure charges to close loan amounts. This issue was taken up by the Competition Commission of India, and an issue was framed whether the behavior of the banks in imposing such foreclosure charges for closing bank loans is anti-competitive in the home loan market. The Commission considered the facts of the case and arguments of the complainant and referred the case for investigation. If you were to observe, I'll pause a little bit here. If you were to observe, all throughout, the Commission does not suo moto act upon any complaint it receives, and it always directs the Director General first to carry out an investigation and then use the report for the purpose of adjudicating the issue. So, in this case also, when it received the complaint, it directed for investigation under Section 26(1) of the Competition Act, and the Director General gave an opportunity to India Bulls. If you observe, please, that an opportunity is being given for India Bulls to be heard. The earlier case, we discussed about opportunity not being given. In this case, an opportunity to India Bulls was given for it to present its fact, and after hearing both the parties, the Commission was of the view that the India Bulls Financial Services is indulged in an act of contravening Sections 3 Subsection 1, Section 3 Subsection 3 Subsection B, Section 3 Subsection 4, and Section 4 Subsection 1 of the Competition Act. And if you observe all these sections, Section 3 particularly deals with anti-competitive agreement, and Section 4 deals with abuse of dominant position, and therefore, finding that the India Bulls is indulged in an act of anti-competitive behavior and directed it under Section 27 of the Competition Act to stop such practice of levying prepayment penalties on foreclosure of loans against purchases of properties. This is perhaps one good case where the Competition Commission has rightly observed that at times dominant companies or corporations which are holding dominant position can impose certain conditions by way of agreements on consumers who are not equipped to understand the language of it and are compelled to pay the money demanded under the guise of these anti-competitive acts of corporation. this is one relevant case which is important, and most often this is a common practice by all financial by all companies that are into financial dealings, and always put the consumers in a disadvantaged position and extort money out of them. This case becomes an important relevant case, and it can be applied to any of such act where a financial company indulges in such kind of anti-competitive behavior. The other case that I am going to discuss is relating to abuse of dominant position again, and also abuse of section 4 of the Competition Act. The facts of this case are that there was a complaint raised by a partnership concern alleging that there is a theatre established in the year 1930s which is called Kerala Film Exhibitors Theatre, and it has indulged in playing only certain films which it felt relevant, and more particularly films that are featured in the language of Kerala, but it dictated as to what film should play in this particular theatre. Now, the producers of the films of Malayalam and Tamil raised an issue saying that they were not allowed to feature their films in this particular theatre. An issue was raised whether the Kerala Film Exhibitors Association or Federation interfered with the distribution of Malayalam and Tamil films to the theatre of the complainant in contravention to the provisions of section 3 and subsection 3 of the Act. This case was taken up and discussed at length, and after hearing the arguments of both the parties, the Commission found that there is a violation of section 3, subsection 3 of the Competition Act, and under Order 27 of the Act, it held that the acts of not allowing the featuring of films, Malayalam and Tamil films, would be considered as anti-competitive, contravening section 3, subsection 3 of the Competition Act. This case can be read along with the cases which you already discussed with regard to abuse of dominant position, and also where prohibited agreements are entered into to preempt another competitor to come into the same relevant market for the purpose of conducting trade. Students, I would recommend and state this, that the judgments can keep changing from case to case and facts to facts, but the principle that's enunciated under the form of these judgments would help you understand the purpose for which the act was enacted, and how the Competition Commission of India, which is shown as a regulatory authority, also adjudicatory body, would deal with the issues relating to anti-competitive regime brought before it. So bear in mind that the judgments or the case laws that I am discussing would not form the complete basis of understanding the act, but they will keep changing with fact scenario and also change in law from time to time. With this, we will continue to understand what sort of penalties are imposed by the Competition Commission of India or the tribunal whenever there is a contravention of the provisions of the act.